this week's broadcast, we talked to Russell Pittman to find out what Europe can learn from the US in terms of rail freight volumes. And we also talked to Arie van Dijk about the ins and outs of the upcoming European Silk Road Summit. This is Rail Freight Live. It's 22nd October. Welcome, everybody. And we are live in the studio from Rotterdam with Arie van Dijk.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Good morning. Good afternoon. Doesn't matter. In China, it's afternoon. The Australian railway company OBB is to invest almost 3 billion euros annually in the railway network in the next 6 years. This adds up to a total amount of 17.5 billion euros on behalf of the federal government. 3 billion euros will go to completely new projects, while another 5 billion is reserved for projects implemented after 2026. It means a great step forward for the railway industry in Austria. But less happy news came from the UK. The disturbed railway line that connects most of the country to Aberdeen needs another month to be restored. Aberdeen is the center of the offshore oil industry, and in August this year, a series of landslides caused the derailment of an express passenger train and extensive damage to the tracks. The route in the northeast of Scotland has been suspended ever since. And soon, fresh goods from Spain will find their way across Europe by train. What started as a fresh line from Spain to the Netherlands will now be extended to the Nordic countries, as well as Germany and the UK. Since 2016, Europol system has been experimenting with the service, which finally began running in 2019. And then the plans for an expanded network of cool rail trains were already underway. And then we are in the preparation stages of the European Silk Road Summit, and we are going to talk about this with Arie van Dijk.
Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. It's only 3 more weeks, or a little bit less, until the summit. What is the current status? Where are we now?
Well, yeah, it's really coming along shortly now. I'm very happy to be back here again, of course. European Silk Road Summit, our main event of the year. In less than 3 weeks, it will take place. We are working very hard to bring it all together because, of course, we're going online this year, so we need to prep way more than before. But it's coming along real nice, and we've got a lot of participants already, so I'm very happy about that. I brought a map, and so we can see from which countries participants are already registered on the via our website. And as you see, of course, Europe, our main base, very well informed. And also China and the countries around the Silk Road Network are registering at this point. And yeah, we're looking to build the bridge, as they say.
So basically everybody that's involved on the European Silk Road comes together on this date online.
Yes, for sure. Yeah. Because normally it would take place physically and everybody needed to come and travel, of course. But this time it's way more easy because you can just register on our website and then you can follow the whole conference from your home. And it will not be a typical webinar. Everybody knows the webinars or the broadcast like this, but we're really going to be multi-hop. So we're going to have different studios, different connections. We even got a connection live with China where a different Silk Road event will be. And yeah, we're going to use each other's knowledge and gain insights in what we can learn from each other.
Yeah, I saw this map appearing on several media pages. Can you explain what this is?
Yeah, this is a very interesting initiative. We started up in anticipation of our event. Of course, you see it's a map similar to what we saw just now. But the BRI is explained here in different lines. Well, I don't have to tell you because you know it for sure very well. But the main corridors are shown. We got the northern, the middle, and the southern corridor. And of course, also the ocean connection. And we gathered it with some interesting data and we made it available for all our readers.
So the new Silk Road began to trade silk for horses.
Well, that's what I learned, yes. Yeah. Yes. And also, we added some facts and figures, some graphs, so you can see the development on the Silk Road. And if you see the container volumes, I remember very well in 2015, we first started writing about it. Everybody was laughing here and also in Rotterdam, the main port. Everybody laughed in my face. It's not to be taken seriously. We all remember that very well, and we won't forget it. But if you see the development now, it's very serious. And people who are paying attention perhaps would say, hey, look, it's going down in 2020. That's, of course, due to COVID or the corona crisis in the world economy. But that is not the case, because this is only the first 6 months.
Yes.
So we are going to see a tremendous increase this year. And
yeah,
the line is really taking off.
Yeah, and I think that's also one of the main topics. What has 2020 done with the volumes on the New Silk Road despite coronavirus? And it's interesting to see, because usually we always discuss the numbers, but this year is, of course, a little bit strange, and we're going to look all into that with analytics and experts.
Yeah, and I think the policy and development of the route and the subsidies that are shown are very important to discuss. But the core always will be, and needs to be, in my opinion, how can we help shippers make the shift to the Silk Road? Or how can we help shippers add the Silk Road to their network in the supply chain?
And I
think that's coming along real nicely.
Yeah, because we see Hugo Boss, that's a shipper. So would he be one of the persons actually explaining what his experience is?
Yeah, because, for instance, Hugo Boss, of course, a brand, so I'm very happy they are on board.
Yeah.
They will tell us and they will explain to us why they have chosen for the Silk Road in their network. What has it gained? What have they gained by adding it to the network? And of course, I'm very curious myself, is what can we learn from their experiences? What can be better? Are we always reliable and so forth? So I'm really looking forward to that. And also a lot of participants are shippers. So I think they would like to mirror them to Hugo Boss and other speakers from, hey, am I experiencing the same thing? Or perhaps they're not even using the Silk Road yet, and they're waiting to be
picked out.
Yeah, yes. We don't know.
And then we have this connection with China. What is on the other side? What's happening on the other side?
On the other side is also a conference, and they will talk about similar topics. We have some Chinese colleagues, of course, from our website, Real Freight CN. And we're really working closely together. So we are trying, of course, here in Europe, we have the conference. In China, they have the conference. We have people who are following both conferences. And we're going to make live connections to speakers there. And they're going to make live connections to speakers here. So it will really become one event. And I think that's very valuable, because it's not just only about shipping goods. It's also understanding each other's culture and how the way to do business together.
Yeah. And I guess that's what you're trying to explain here. There's virtual matchmaking. Is that actually, is it just people meeting each other, or are there certain...
No, because, of course, the meeting part of the conference, of the Silk Road Summit, is one of the biggest pluses. It's one of the most important things. And I think people, when they think it's going to go online, okay, I'm going to see a bunch of presentations, and I'm not going to be able to meet anybody. But that's not the case, because we invested heavily, of course, in our studio equipment and technical, but also in the software part. And we're really happy that we have a system now that's really going to mix and match participants.
Yeah.
So if you participate in this event, for sure you will gain new contacts, because there will be several moments in which we're going to connect you on the base of your profile with others. So we're going to add shippers and logistic service providers together, so they can match and they can help each other perhaps in solving their supply chain issues.
Yeah, okay. So lots to learn. It's a two-day event, 10 and 11 November. And what I can tell from my side is that we don't only have presentations, because that's also what you mentioned. We're not just going to look at people presenting. We're doing it a little bit differently this year. So we have videos as well, and video reports. We're actually going out to the speakers in wherever we go, because the speakers cannot always come to us, so we visited them. There's, for example, one example that I really liked is, this is Ukraine. It's Mostiska. It's on the border with Poland and Ukraine. And we had a camera woman, Irinka, who actually went on her Saturday evening, 8 o'clock by train to this place to film a train coming in from Poland. And it was really nice.
This is a Silk Road train?
Yeah, this is a Silk Road train. It will be further distributed.
Okay. And this was going to Europe or to China?
No, it was going towards China. From Poland.
Okay.
So it was very well arranged with everybody who was involved. They told us when the train is departing from Poland and when it's arriving. And now you should start driving. And that makes me realize that everybody is with us on this conference. We just have this whole club of people together networking, and already in this stage you can notice that we have this nice community going on.
Yeah, and because I think because it's online, it offers a lot of people the opportunity to participate who were earlier not able to travel or so forth. Yeah. They can really learn a lot by watching online, and I think it's very cool that we have so many partners who go out and get the stories where it happened.
Exactly. And the next slide, you can see some of the train people. I'm not sure if the driver is among them, but these are the people actually driving the train, sitting here having a break. And we usually don't get to see these people when you go to a conference, because there you just see one person in a suit standing on the stage explaining some beautiful story. But now we have the chance to see what's really going on.
This is what makes the Silk Road one. These are the Silk Road heroes.
So yes, exactly. And I think that's an added advantage of having this online conference, that we now go a little bit more towards the actual people and they don't come to us. So that's
very
nice.
Cool.
And,
very cool. I hope they can also participate a little bit and perhaps see some of the presentations also.
We offered everybody involved to come and watch.
So. Very nice.
And there's another example, the last one, that's yesterday it was shot. This is an airport. You wonder why are we on an airport?
The Silk Road.
And you may also wonder why are these nice waffles here, but they are connected.
They smell good in any case.
Yes, you can have one. Ah. Go ahead. This is Liège. This is the airport of Liège, and this is a very important hub on the New Silk Road. It's in Belgium, and what got our interest is that here they work together. So you have air freight and rail freight in the same premise, working together, sitting in the same booking office, and basically getting customers in saying, okay, this is for rail, this is for air. And we thought that was unique. We wanted to hear more about it, so we visited them yesterday. We got a chance to talk about everything with the rail guys and with the air freight guys. And we had a beautiful experience of standing on the balcony where nobody else can stand, watching the airplanes take off, as you can see. And we also made another film here. So this
That's very interesting, because the Silk Road, when it first started to run, people were saying, well, you're going to see it's a real competition to air freight and ocean freight.
Yeah.
But in this example, it's more like an addition to the network, or...
That's what they say, and that's what we found very interesting. We asked them, so how do you deal with each other in this competition field? And they said, no, we don't compete, we just work together.
So, but where do the planes go then to China?
Yep.
Okay. Very interesting, very looking forward to hear all about that.
And we brought the waffles home, and we brought the speakers home with a video. This can be seen during the summit. To be like a short documentary, so that's another way of bringing the speakers to the audience.
Great. Well, I'm looking forward.
Yeah. So I guess that's enough for today about the European Silk Road Summit taking place 10 and 11 November. Sign up now. Then another thing: the huge high-speed rail project in the UK, the London and Birmingham HS2 line, will enable growth in rail freight usage at UK ports. This is according to a new promotion by the rail developers aimed at winning over operators around the UK. A slick video presentation shot on location at Tilbury's Intermodal Container Terminal emphasizes the capacity enhancements the new line will bring all across the network.
So London Container Terminals is part of the Port of Tilbury, the biggest port on the River Thames, spanning 1,100 acres. So we have our own rail terminal here that has daily service handling everyday products that get distributed throughout the UK to the Midlands, to Wales and as far as Scotland. Products then come back on the same trains, British products that are then distributed throughout the rest of the UK and indeed exported globally. We pride ourselves on being the port in the UK that handles the most recyclable products. And a really good example of that is one of our customers, URM, who are one of the world leaders in the recycling of glass. And what they do here is they sort the glass, they process it, that they've gathered from across the south of England, and then it gets rail freighted to Cheshire, where it's recycled into new bottles. An important part of being able to offer a rail service is the fact that rail is only 25% of the carbon emissions of the road equivalent, and it also helps with congestion on the road networks too. The great thing about HS2 is that it will offer more slots for freight because it will take the fastest trains off of the existing network onto the new rail line. So that will mean that we can offer those slots to our customers. It will also mean that for passengers, there will be no capacity for more services. So it means that everyone will benefit even if they're not using the HS2 service.
And what can Europe learn from the US when it comes to increasing the rail freight volumes? Russell Pittman provided some insightful recommendations during the Track Access Charges Summit 2020. US volumes have increased considerably over the years, something that the European industry can only be jealous about. Let's have a look at an interview with the American economist. And for our next speaker, we're going to have a look overseas again, as the US seems to be a great example of how rail freight can be a competitive mode of transport. We're going to talk with Russell Pittman, who is the Director of Economic Research in the Antitrust Division of the US Department of Justice. And Russell, are you with us?
I am with you. Can you hear me?
Yes, I can hear you. Russell, thank you.
Pleasure to be at my second TrackCess Charges Summit.
Welcome. And we mentioned that there were some people from the US. I think you, where in the US are you based?
I'm in Washington, D.C. If you look behind me, I must correct you. Unfortunately, it is not 4 p.m.
That's what I was afraid of because I saw you nodding. What time is it there now?
4:30 a.m.
Wow. Okay. All the respect to you. You woke up for the track access charges. Thank you very much. Russell, you drew a comparison between the U.S. and Europe. And you said that in U.S. rail freight owes a lot to the Staggers deal. Could you explain why that is?
Well, in the U.S., as many of you probably know, we have a very different rail freight system. We have vertically integrated railways. The railway companies own their track, own their infrastructure, and mostly run their own trains on their track. The same is similar in Canada and Mexico and Brazil. So I think of this as the North American system. We until 1980, from the creation of the railways in the 1800s, there was heavy regulation to protect what were seen as very vulnerable farmers, small manufacturers, citizens from the monopolistic abuses of the railways. Gradually, the railways, under heavy regulation and, of course, increasing competition from other modes, lost their monopoly power with respect to many shippers, and they were in serious financial trouble starting about in the 60s. And so, by 1980, there had been a series of minor deregulation bills passed or partial deregulation. By 1980, the freight system was very much deregulated, substantially deregulated. And the results, as are on one of my slides that I think you're gonna show, were just dramatic in terms of productivity going up, of prices going down, of volume going up. Eventually profits the profits are not on that graph, but profits were quite healthy and growing and now are quite healthy. And so it's been one of the world's I would say success stories in terms of both keeping the railways healthy and in reversing what had been a very perceptible decline in rail's share of freight. It has now been going back up since 1980, whereas it had been declining continuously since at least the 1930s. And we'll talk about this more maybe if we have time, but I think one of the lessons obviously, there are many differences between the U.S. and the North American systems and the European systems, and I don't minimize those at all. But I think one of our big advantages has been that our infrastructure is mostly privately funded because the railway companies own their infrastructure, or in Mexico and Brazil, they don't own it, but they control it. And so they have the incentive to invest really tens of billions of dollars throughout the continent of private money into the infrastructure. And I think it's what has been a very important factor in resuming freight's rail share, increasing share of freight, not of passengers, unfortunately, but of freight. And I think it's something that, you know, if you were, I think people at the Access Summit in Riga last year heard me say, boy, in Europe, I don't tell you what to do from America. But if you could figure out a way to attract more private investment into the infrastructure, I think that would be a big key.
Yeah, and I think it becomes very clear if we look at a similar development that happened in Europe when it comes to rail freight, and you've also shown this in another slide of yours, because in Europe we had deregulation too.
Yes, I hesitate to talk about this in front of a group of people who know about this much better than I, but I'm using the results of a paper that I recently published with several European colleagues on the share of rail in agricultural in grain haulage in Eastern Europe. For the most part, was our focus, but we were talking about the broader issue as well, looking at the four packages, looking at what the policy of the EC was going back to the first package, in terms of trying to increase interoperability and promote the union, but also trying to increase competition and above the rail. And one of the things that we found in the countries we were looking at specifically, and in the great data that the EC itself puts together, is that the policy on the freight side, especially, was what we looked at, was quite successful in creating competition above the rail in a number of countries. Very, very significant share of the non-incumbent in freight, and yet the share of rail continued to fall. And so that was, you know, one of the conclusions that I'll admit I kind of pushed into that paper as well, as well. You created competition, very successful, well done. Probably promoted efficiency, as I understand it, but you weren't able to prevent the continued drop of rail share. And so again, I come back to my message of it's the infrastructure that maybe needs a lot more money. The problem may be not above the rail, but below the rail.
Yeah.
Again, with apologies that I'm talking about a continent that everybody listening to me knows much better than I.
And we're now showing your slide, your third slide, in which you say the private money is out there. Rail companies, infrastructure managers, and policymakers need to find a way to use it.
Exactly. Yeah. And if you look at the left of that slide, you see the figure from the Association of American Railroads. Again, tens of billions in the U.S. alone, not even counting Canada, Mexico, Brazil. Tens of billions of dollars every year of private investment in the infrastructure. The companies are listed on the stock exchange. They raise money. They spend it. They do get some government help occasionally, but by far the most of the infrastructure spending comes directly from their shareholders.
Yeah. Well, maybe it's an interesting question for the listening audience. Why is it not happening in Europe? Why do we're not able to attract private investment? Who knows? Maybe somebody knows. Would you be able to give an answer to that question?
My own answer is that it's kind of inherent in it's probably inherent in the government ownership of the infrastructure, because throughout the world, not just in Europe, but everywhere, governments are unreliable sources of continuous funding for infrastructure. Every year the parliament has to allocate money, and every year the pensioners need it and the military needs it, and golly, the track will last another year. And just all over the world, Russia, Ukraine, India, Europe, governments cannot be counted on to fund rail infrastructure to the degree that it needs to be.
Right. That's a very clear and strong message. And with that, we've come to an end of this week's Rail Freight Dive. You can follow us on YouTube, and of course, you can read our daily news on the website of railfreight.com. See you next week. Goodbye.
en ook u kunt hier zitten, want deze coronaproof studio is te huur voor uw congres, vergadering of webinar. We hebben alle techniek in huis om u hierbij te helpen. Kijk voor meer informatie op promedia.nl. Ik zie u graag in onze studio.